moving here was mostly an accident.
I love all the interesting things that go on in cities. I love the life of the mind in cities, but the struggle of living there physically and perceptually was difficult.
I was the person who blocked the power lines, because you know what they would have done is they would have brought a power line either all the way around the road right through all of my view, or they would have just jumped it right over the top of my house. And I just really didn't want that to happen to this beautiful area.
That's the first version of the internet connection. That talks directly to a matching unit on top of the peak over here. It's a 5 gigahertz system, so it's not competing with all of the Wi-Fi in the neighborhood. The phone company refuses to install any more cable. They could go down to the bottom of the hill down here and plug a couple of cards into the box and give all of us DSL up here, but they won't do it. So, we went around them. I'm the instigator of it all. I was the guy who figured out how to get the signal up there and talked a friend of mine into actually creating all this. This is one of the receivers. There's about 200 people in the valley now that have these. And I have no urge to rebel against things that are working. It's just what you do if nobody else has managed to solve that problem. What actually got me to move here was...
I was working in the computer industry in the Bay Area, and they built this fancy new headquarters building and sent out this 15-page employee handbook saying that we would no longer be able to turn off the fluorescent lights and bring in our own lighting and our own decoration. And I just said, no, I will not work under fluorescent lights. And I said, I'm out of here. Well, they said, okay, you're out of here. And so I moved up here, just cut off everything and started camping in a little cabin I built inside the barn.
This was home for a few years. It was great fun. 8x12 plywood building, and that was the original place where I lived for years. Yeah, I built the whole thing. It was wonderful. That was actually one of the happiest times of my life. Actually, my main reason for building the house was to have something real to hang all my solar panels on. I didn't need that much space. As you'll see, once you get to see the house, a lot of it is the greenhouse or solar collector. I gradually built the house. Actually, I hired somebody to build the house, and they spent all of the money and built half of the house. And so I've been building the rest of it ever since. So what we've got here is the big glassed-in greenhouse or solarium area, which is collecting a lot of natural solar heat. And then two solar hot water panels on the right end and 8 solar electric panels across the top. And then the left end over there is a solar hot air collector, which right now is taking the heat from the top of the greenhouse, running it up the front of that slightly yellower path of metal, and can either close the top up there and push it into the house when you want more heat, or open the top and vent the excess heat out into the outside air. This is the outflow from the solar flue. And if you put your hand up here, you can feel the heat coming down. And then, of course, in the summer, when you don't want that heat, there's a lid up on top that the computer can open so that all the heat from the greenhouse and the excess heat that's right in here can just go right outdoors. You can access it from anything with a SSH terminal, so I can do it on my phone. So now it's going to go off shortly. Oh wait, no, that was the ozone going off. I need to turn it off. Off. It scans every 10 seconds to see if it needs to do something.
So sometimes you need to wait a little while. That's what happens when you're a techie and you can change things. You do change things. All the exterior doors have a magnetic sensor and an air cylinder that pops out when it's locked. If the doors are all closed, that the magnetic sensor tells you they're all closed, then the computer can spit out the little lock buttons and lock all the doors. This is the key lock for the whole house. And if you lock it, then you can see that it has actually pushed out the cylinder. This is a magnetic switch, and this is a corresponding magnet. And so when the door is closed, they meet and throw the switch. So then you just put all the switches all the way around the house in series, and it knows if all the doors are locked.
Looks very simple.
If you're in a city, you'd want a more powerful lock. And there's no reason that deadbolt couldn't have an electric actuator. I really picked the air cylinders because it didn't require continuous power.
Normally the computer does that.
I actually bypass the sensors.
When was that? The first time you just introduced this?
It was part of building the house, 1986.
Wow.
Yeah, at that time there was no commercial product available.
It was 2 years after the Macintosh. That was almost the beginning of modern personal computing. And you were doing this in here, okay.
Do you have other sensors in your home?
Most of them are inserted in or under or behind things. There's a sensor at the top left corner of those hot water panels that tells the computer how hot the water right up there is. And then there's another sensor in the bottom of the storage tank in the bathroom. When it's 7 degrees hotter up here, it turns on the pump and pumps the water downstairs. When it's no longer warmer up here, then it turns the pump off. Big lower solar electric panels have their own dedicated maximum power point tracker, but if you look right above the top edge of them, there are four smaller panels that are kind of laid back behind them, and those are still run by the computer. When it sees power coming in the morning, it switches the switch on. There's two ways to do it. You can have a physical relay or switch that disconnects them at night, or you can have a diode in between so that power can't flow backwards through the panels at night. And it turns out that the voltage drop across the diode wastes way more power than running the computer and using a real switch, which just totally turns it off.
My solar system is trying to be my only source of hot water. Most people's solar system is adding its heat to a gas or electric heater, and if it works, great. If it doesn't, they hardly notice.
What I use when there's no solar is this big old wood stove out here. These are the hot water coils that collect the heat. Because it feeds the same heat exchanger, you can heat the whole house from here. You can heat your domestic water from here. And then it has a sheet metal case around the outside and directs what would otherwise be wasted heat back into the bathroom through those brass grids here on the wall.
There are three temperature sensors. There's one of them right here. In the very end of this, there's a little, it's a TO92 plastic transistor case. And what it has in it is called a one-wire network, which with one signal wire and a ground wire, it can communicate data. And so that's just a very simple way to get an outdoor temperature, and you can see the same wires go up here to the input and output of the water heating stove. So all of those go back to the computer, and they all of the different temperature sensors of that type talk over the same exact wire in sequence. It's a very tricky protocol, but it can be done.
Are those cans?
Yeah, these are just soup cans, so that the temperature sensors aren't affected by the air out here in the cold, and they get an actual sense of what's in the pipe.
And why are you monitoring air temperature?
when there's a fire in there, you need to keep water moving through it, otherwise it will overheat and boil. So the computer can tell if it's hot, and then as it cools off, the computer can say, well, you know, it's not very hot anymore, let's stop it for a while, and then we'll turn it on in a minute or 2 minutes or 5 minutes and see if there's any heat left. But it relieves me of having to decide, is that fire over, should I turn the pump off now? There's another one of these in the water storage tank in the bathroom, and there's two more that do the same thing for the gas water heater. This is the heart of the hot water heating system. Any heat that comes from that wood stove or from the solar panels on the roof or from the gas heater is run through heat exchanger coils inside this tank to heat 100 gallons of water that just stays here. It just sits there and stores heat. When you want domestic hot water, there's a separate heat exchanger going through the same tank of water that flash heats the water that you're about to use. And it is amazing. It gets it within 1 degree of the temperature of the water in the tank. I was very suspicious of heat exchangers originally, but if you have enough area, it works great.
This is the big glassed-in greenhouse or solarium area, which is collecting a lot of natural solar heat.
So you actually use this as a greenhouse as well?
Yeah, it's nice to have tomatoes in December. And this is about a four-year-old kale plant.
And they all have drip. One more of the gadgets that runs the gardens.
How does this one work?
Well, there's a hose comes in here, and down underneath there's a pressure reducer and a automatic valve and a filter and a bunch of stuff, and the computer just sends it a signal and says dump some water in the greenhouse.
Now why do you use the computer to do drip irrigation? Because couldn't you just...
You can buy commercial controllers, but this does everything. The ozone out in the tank knows when the water pump needs to run, and so it can turn one thing off and save power. Let's see.
It combines a whole lot of different control functions into one little efficient place.
This is the basic display of what gadgets are on and what gadgets are off. This is input for AC pump, input for DC pump, input for well pump, PV panels and PV, whether it's charging the positive or negative battery more. These are all the irrigation outputs. And there you can see it just did something, turned on the ozone and the well pump. The wood stove starts are zero because the wood stove obviously isn't running. Let's see, right now the solar flue is lowercase, so it's off. And if I wanted it on, I would type SF, and it tells me it's off. And I press plus, and it tells me it will be on. And now it's going to, somewhere in the next 10 seconds, it's going to notice that I changed a condition. And there it goes, and it's done what I told it to. And of course you can get all kinds of reports. It is totally custom for this house. It's like me captured and put in the box.
You need a server running all the time?
It's a little microcomputer. It does run all the time. Every 10 seconds, it gets an interrupt, and it scans all of the possible sensors and figures out, does anything need to change? And then it will turn things on or off. This, the part you see here is the old original analog controls. And then hidden inside, the actual computer is this part. And then these are I/O processors. And this is just various stuff to make all the sensors work. This corner runs all those one-wire sensors. You have to have active pull-up and pull-downs. You heard that beep? That means something just... Oh! It just opened the solar flue lid because... It's measuring temperature right here, actually. And I shined this hot light on this sensor. And it said, it's hot in the house. It's time to open the solar flue. There's a hot plate collector on the other side of this wall, and that air goes up clear to the ceiling, and then this tube brings it back down into the house when the lid is closed. And then when the lid is open, the hot air from the greenhouse goes outdoors, and the hot air from here also goes outdoors. Somewhere up here, there's a little Bluetooth dongle hanging from a wire so that you can always check what's going on from a phone or a tablet. If you're off somewhere else and you know that it's a very, very hot day, you might want to give the greenhouse an extra dose of water. Or in the winter, if you're out and you know you're going to get home really late and you haven't collected any solar heat, you can tell it, turn on that gas heater and make me a hot shower. Oh, that's the well pump. Oh, it must be, is it noon?
Yeah.
It must be watering the garden. And so it took some water out of the tank and the well pump decided, oh, I can put water back in the tank. This is the electronic control unit that communicates with the pump at the bottom of the well.
You talk like in third person, as if it would be an individual system by itself.
Well, I think of computers talking to things, yeah. I guess that's...
they are, right? I mean, in a sense, at this point, you don't have to be involved.
Right.
I love the details in your home. I think it's so beautiful. Even how you store your clothes is beautiful.
Yeah, it was kind of an accident, but the...
Oh, really?
The bookcase was there.
So this is a bookcase closet?
Yeah, just got adopted.
And you think there is a global approach to a living experience?
Almost every choice I make is my own personal feeling about things. And there's no mental philosophy behind it that says this, therefore, all this stuff. It's like, if I have a choice to make, I look at what's going to make me happier, what's going to make me more comfortable. I love sleeping on the floor, and it's good for you. I mean, I talk to people my age who say what a hard time they have getting up out of their beds because the bed isn't high enough and they have to struggle. And I can be laying on the floor and do a single flip and be standing up because I do it all the time. So what's not to like? And it turns out that a lot of things that most people seek just don't make me happy or comfortable. I discovered induction cooking, which is a fantastic way to use solar power. Underneath here is a big magnetic coil, and you use steel or pan or a pan with a steel bottom added to it, and it makes the steel itself hot. The surface of this only gets warm from the pan. And this one has little tap controls like a smartphone does. You can select temperature, and so the only thing you're heating is the pan that you're cooking. Technically, it has nothing to do with microwaves, but conceptually, it's like a microwave oven. It's fast, it's efficient, it's electronically controlled, and it's not messy. This is the DC power that's wired all through the house. I did it because 30 years ago, it was more efficient. Now, I would probably suggest that people just wire for AC, and I would never give up my DC lighting. But that's my own personal thing. Most people don't see the flicker of regular lights. This is probably the most bizarre audio amplifier anybody's ever seen. It is totally DC coupled, and it is not self-balancing. And it runs directly off of these big old lead acid batteries behind there. I was running a repair shop for audio equipment, and I had the opportunity to see and hear all kinds of different equipment, and gradually started noticing that some sounded better than others to me. And it had nothing to do with how they sounded to other people or what they cost. And so I started building something that used the main principles of all of these, and then I just went with it as far as I could and tried different things. The criteria for developing this sound equipment was, can I walk around in the sound space and feel where I am?
And to me, the idea that you sit in the magic seat in the middle of the space between the two speakers is just absolutely limiting and wrong. I don't know anybody else whose goal is to create a sound field that you can walk around in and feel that you're moving through something real. Anyway, it's one more crazy aside from my life. Most people, I think, believe that a whole lot of their life is predetermined and is not subject to change and doesn't have to be considered. This is just how it is. That's the big new water tank. It's just fresh water storage. And somehow, for me, everything is something that needs to be considered. The inside here is an ozone system that's pumping gas up through there and bubbling it into the water so that it stays fresh. Ozone is oxygen with an extra oxygen ion attached to it, and it desperately wants to get rid of that extra third oxygen molecule and set it free. So then you've got loose free oxygen, which is what you need to oxygenate anything that is living in there and destroy it. So it's the ultimate bleach. When it's used up, there's nothing left but oxygen. So it's much nicer than putting chlorine in your water where the chlorine stays there forever. The city plants, most of them now use ozone to start with, to get the water clean. But the one advantage chlorine has is that it leaves a residual for hours, whereas all of the ozone effect is gone in minutes. The computer turns this on when there's excess solar energy. If I was to turn on something big in the house, this would go off. Well, I have ripe tomatoes in the garden already.
So do you have any kind of automatic irrigation or?
Oh yeah, the computer does that. There are four different zones out here that it controls. Pretty much everything that you see that's green has somewhere or another a little drip emitter. There's one.
And so you have to program this.
Right. These guys are my favorite drip emitters because they're infinitely adjustable. Now, this is the only reason I have a garden is because it's all automatically watered.
Having a sort of smarter home, you think, is it something that more of us do?
A lot of people have automated irrigation. Of course, it's run by a separate control box. I think a lot of it is going on, but it's starting with controlling the audiovisual system and the lights in the home theater and those kind of things, I think, will start to grow together. And people that have an experimental bent will start putting them together out of little microcontrollers and Lego-style plug-together modules. Along the very left edge of the greenhouse in the back, there's a brown stripe. That's supposed to be glassed in, so that the air that the vent sucks comes under the floor of the living room, down through the tunnel in the middle of this concrete block area, and then is sucked in through that grid. That's the intake for the whole solar flue tunnel. If it was operating, it would take hot air through that brown grid, down through the concrete blocks, under the living room floor, up the brown stripe along the far edge of the greenhouse, and then up along the roof and out through the ceiling.
You're just unwilling to accept that anything, and there's any reality that you have to accept. You choose your own reality.
Well, it's basic scientific method. You make a hypothesis and you go do some research and see what you can find out, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. But what other basis is there to make those choices?
The people who actually built the structure had used sheetrock and paint, and that was definitely not strong enough to handle the sun and the heat. So it's now all made of hardy board, the concrete and fiber board. My grandmother's house was built out of it 100 years ago. It's been around quite a while, and then it kind of disappeared, and then now it's come back as a fireproof material. It's wonderful stuff for building solar collectors out of.
Most people, I think, believe that a whole lot of their life is predetermined and is not subject to change and doesn't have to be considered. Okay. Yes. If you totally believe that you want audio, you go to the audio store, you spend money, you get something better. But for me, price had no relationship to what I heard. Any time now, it should, that opened me up to say, okay, I need to do my own research on what does work for me. It would normally open like that once a day when it gets hot, and then sometimes even in the middle of the night, it takes before it actually closes, depending on how hot the house got. You know, stop and think and feel about how have the things you've tried so far affected you. Talk to other people that maybe have tried some other things that you haven't tried, and go look and see what else is out there.